stumpy little man ran down the dusty road, his arms flailing about, his little legs carrying him just as fast as he could go. It had been many a year since he'd run that fast. By the time that he arrived at his destination, he bent down, hands to his knees, trying to catch his breath. He felt like falling face first into the ground. He needed time to recover, but there was no time to waste. There was no time for rest. Later on that evening, the same stumpy little man sat down in the comfort of his home. His heart rate was back to normal, and he was with family and friends, and everything in his world was right. Everything was right. He had never been happier in his life than in that moment. He was right with God, and he was right with his friends, his neighbors, and his community. There are times in life where we come to a crossroad. You think you're going down the right path. You think your life is heading in a good direction. And then, boom, you're confronted. And something happens. And everything about your life is flipped upside down. And so this morning, we are going to engage with a story. A story about a stumpy little running man. And I think you could find yourself in his story. I think that maybe later home this afternoon, sitting with your family or enjoying the sunshine on your deck, I think you could be thinking, wow, everything is right in my life. My life has never looked as good as it does in this moment right now. So those little stumpy little legs that ran the sprint, they were tired, but there was no time to rest. And so the little man reached to the lowest branch on the tree closest to him, and he hoisted himself up. Hugging the tree, he scooched himself up that tree as far as he could go. And just like running, it had been a long time since he had climbed a tree. Wealthy men don't typically climb trees. If they needed something up a tree, they just pay somebody to go up there for them, right? This short, little, stumpy, wealthy man was the perfect storm of dislike. All of his wealth had been obtained by legal thievery of his neighbors. And so he was despised by his community. He was maligned in the streets. He was talked about in back rooms. Even his own mother was ashamed of who he was. And so this little, stumpy, wealthy, thieving, despised man climbed the tree as hard and as fast as he could. Now I'm just going to tell you, a mad pit bull could send me up a tree. A snorting, raging bull that was chasing me would send me up a tree. But probably not much else. There was a few years ago, we were out camping, and my little nieces and nephews, they were all like climbing this tree, and they said, "Uncle Josh, climb the tree with us." And I tried, and that was the end of that, right? Not going to happen anymore. But this little stumpy wealthy man wasn't being chased. That's not what caused him to climb. It was a crowd that caused him to climb. It was a moving crowd that was coming down the road, a crowd that he needed to stay separate from. And so there he is, sitting in this tree, his little legs just a dangling down. And his mind begins thinking about the reason why he's up this tree. How has he found himself up this tree? And as his mind is racing, he begins to think about all the things that have transpired during that day. Earlier that day, he had heard that another rich man had met Jesus just a couple of towns over. And he was told that this little man was told that Jesus told the rich man that to enter heaven, he had to sell everything that he had. And word was on the street that Jesus claimed that it was easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into heaven. And being a rich man himself, he figured out the physics. Camel, big. Needle, small. Oh no, I'm never getting to heaven. But then he heard that Jesus made a claim that what is impossible with man is possible through him. And this gave him hope. He'd also heard a report about Blind Bill. Blind Bill was a beggar that had always sat on the outskirts of town. And he had heard that Blind Bill began yelling at this Jesus. As Jesus walked by, Blind Bill was just yelling at him. And the crowd was doing everything they could to shut Blind Bill up. Silence, don't talk to Jesus. Just stay out of the way. But Blind Bill just kept yelling louder and yet louder and louder, begging Jesus for mercy. And instead of passing him by, Jesus actually stopped and took time to meet old Blind Bill. And the report that this little stumpy man had heard was that Blind Bill wasn't blind anymore since he'd met Jesus. That now he was running through the streets of town all over the place, just praising God that he had been healed, that he could see again. And so, hearing that this same Jesus was going to be passing through his side of town, he began to think, well, if Blind Bill really did get healed, and rich men can get to heaven through this Jesus, then maybe there's hope for this stubby little rich guy that nobody cares for. And so he began to run through town to get to a place where perhaps he would have the best chance to see Jesus. And that's how he found himself in that tree. And he found himself in that tree just waiting, just giddy as a little schoolgirl, just waiting for that moment that he would get to see this Jesus for himself. Hope had sprung in his heart. And so you may think that it was his little arms and his stumpy little legs that got him up that tree. Maybe you think that perhaps he'd gotten a boost from somebody on the street and he'd just seen somebody and said, hey, I'll pay you $100 if you help me up the tree. But really what got him up that tree was faith. Faith that what is impossible with man is possible in Jesus. So there he was in the tree. He had left his humility on the ground. He was exposed for the whole town to see. And that's when Jesus passed by. But instead of just walking on by, Jesus stopped right there by the tree and looked up. You know, what a moment that must have been for Zacchaeus. I mean, there's Zacchaeus looking down at Jesus. And Jesus looks up at him. And the crowd that is surrounding Jesus, the crowd that is walking with him, stops. And they look up to see what Jesus is looking at. In that moment, they see Zacchaeus. Simultaneously and unanimously, they would have all welled up with pride. The crowd would have begun to think, get him, Jesus, right? That thieving tax collector swindled me out of $5,000 last year. I was barely able to feed my children while he's living high on the hog. He's in bed with the Romans. He's no son of Abraham. I hope Jesus gives him everything that he deserves. And in that moment of truth, Jesus opened his mouth. And if you've ever sung the song, you know exactly what he said, right? Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. Here's the thing, though. We need to be a little bit nicer to Zacchaeus. First of all, who wants to be called a wee little man, right? Bill's like, amen. But do you remember singing that song as a child? And when we would sing the song, Zacchaeus, you come down, right? When he said Zacchaeus' name, there was no scorn. There was no tone of voice that would lead you to believe that Jesus didn't want anything to do with him. He simply and literally just wanted to go to his house and spend some time with him. Hey, Zacchaeus, man, come on down. I want to go to your house. All the while, the crowd began to cast their glances onto Jesus and Zacchaeus. They began to mutter underneath their breath about this interaction. Well, Zacchaeus came down a lot faster than he got up, right? Of course, gravity helped with that quite a bit. But I also imagine that there was an urgency, that there was a burden that had been lifted off of Zacchaeus' shoulders. I imagine that there was a spring in his step because Jesus had called his name. Now, you might wonder when the moment of faith was for Zacchaeus. When did he truly come to faith in Christ? Was it when he heard about the encounter with the rich ruler and felt hope for the first time? Was it when he heard of how Jesus had healed the blind man on the outskirts of town? Was it when he decided to run through the town and scurry up a tree just to see Jesus? I mean, it would have taken a lot for a stumpy, wealthy guy to sprint through town and then climb a tree. When did faith take root in his heart? All of those moments were when faith was being awakened in Zacchaeus. But faith truly took root in Zacchaeus' life at the base of the tree after Jesus had called his name. If you want to turn to the Gospel of Luke chapter 19, we're just going to read a couple of verses of Scripture this morning. Luke chapter 19, verse 8, this is the moment where faith took root in Zacchaeus' heart. Verse 8 says this, but Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. This had been building up in his heart. Zacchaeus was a Jew. He knew that there was a God, and he knew that he needed to be right with God by the Old Testament scripture. And in this moment, he realizes that the path that he had been on, his way of living, was all about looking out for himself. It was stealing from people and getting for himself and pursuing his own dreams. But in this moment that we see in Scripture, he turns from all of those things, and he turns to Jesus in faith, and he turns to be reconciled to all those people that he had stolen from and been so evil towards. Now, the Scripture doesn't say it like this, but I can just imagine that what Zacchaeus did is he pulled out this money bag, and he just, all over the ground, he said, look, here it is. take it. Whoever I've harmed, whoever I've stolen from, it's theirs. I'll pay them right back. This was the moment of repentance for Zacchaeus. This was the moment when he recognized that his money, that his wealth, that his pursuit of happiness didn't matter at all. That he needed to be rescued. And so he reaches out in faith to Jesus. And isn't that how it works? We move through life. We're trying to get it all together. We pursue financial gain for security. We try to find the right guy, or we try to find the right girl that we want to spend our lives with because we think we need somebody to be happy. We buy houses and we buy cars. We buy gadgets to make us feel secure, to make us feel more like the people around us. We strive for all these things because we think that's what's going to make us happy. But then there's that moment in life where we come to that crossroad. And Jesus is revealed to us. Perhaps he's revealed through a story like the story of Zacchaeus. Maybe a friend shares Christ with us. Maybe it's through picking up a Gideon Bible in a hotel room. But we come to this crossroad where Jesus is revealed to us, and then there's this tugging that goes on inside of our hearts that's unexplainable. We could just explain it like something's tugging at my heart. That I need to turn to Jesus in faith. And so I want to ask this morning, do you sense that call on your life? Do you hear Jesus calling your name? Do you feel that tug on your heart? If so, I just want to encourage you to respond and say yes to Jesus. Say yes to him. It'll be the absolute best decision you'll ever make in your entire life. Amen, church. I want you to look at verse 9 with me. Look at verse 9. Jesus said to him, remember what Zacchaeus has just done. He's emptied out the money bag and he said, here it is. Here's my wealth. Right? Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. He is a son of Abraham. So as we think about this story, by the way, perhaps one of the shortest sermons I've preached in a long time, right? As we think about the story, here's the first thing we've got to get from this passage. All of us come to Jesus in different ways, but we all come to Jesus the same way, right? We don't all climb a tree as part of our conversion experience, but metaphorically, we all climb a tree. That's when we realize that we have a need. Right? Understand that as I told that story, like, right, I took a lot of liberties with it. But somehow, in some way, Zacchaeus began to understand that there was a need in his life. I mean, why else would a wealthy little stumpy man have run through town and climbed into a tree unless he was desperate for change, unless he realized that there was a need in his life? Recognizing that we have a need is the starting point. And here's what happens. The Holy Spirit moves into our world and allows us to get frustrated to help us see this need. You know that? God will allow you to get frustrated. Because if you don't, how else will you ever know that you have a need? We're moving down this path. We think we've got everything figured out, that if we just get these certain things that are, then our life would be as it should be. But then the Holy Spirit comes in and allows these frustrations to come and help us see that we don't have it all together, that we do have a need for a Savior. And then second, there's the call from Jesus. He calls your name. And he says, come to me, all you who are weary and carrying all those burdens, and I'll give you rest. Because I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can get to heaven. Nobody can get to God. Nobody can get to the Father except going through me. Jesus calls your name. And it's not an audible voice, but we hear it in our hearts. And then third, there's this convergence of faith called repentance. That's when we recognize how broken and needy we are, and we turn from all of that stuff. We turn from our own way of doing things. We turn from our life of sin. We turn from our pride. We turn from striving to achieve. And we turn to Jesus. We empty out our metaphorical money bags of our lives out onto the floor at His feet. And we say, here it is, Jesus. Here's all I have. It's yours. I don't care about my wealth anymore. I don't care about my pride anymore. I don't care what the person next to me is gonna think. I'm gonna stop holding on to those things that I've tried so hard to get. Those things that make me feel significant. Those things that make me feel secure. I don't care about them anymore. Jesus, I just want you. And when we turn from our own path and turn to Jesus in faith, what we find is He changes our heart. He gives us a new heart. And we find a changed life. So, we see the process of faith beginning in our lives in this story. And I pray that you have come to that crossroad yourself. And can I tell you, if you haven't, make today the day that you respond to Jesus calling your name. He's calling. He's calling your name. But not only do we see the crossroad, there's also a warning in the text for us. It's a warning to not be like the crowd. Don't be like the crowd who muttered underneath their breath in their own self-righteousness. The crowd in the story represents the people who wanted to walk with Jesus, but they didn't want to follow Jesus. We see the crowd in chapter 18 trying to get the blind beggar to shut up and not bother Jesus. We see the crowd looking down on Zacchaeus and muttering underneath their breath as Jesus ministers to them. We see the crowd saying, listen, Jesus, we're the ones that got it all together, right? Zacchaeus doesn't. He's a thief. He's in bed with the Romans. You don't need him. You need to move on and stick with us. And the warning is, don't be like the crowd. Don't be like the crowd. Now, there's a lot of ways we find ourselves being the crowd. Perhaps you were born in church, right? Your first Sunday service, you were a week old. And your parents were Christians. Maybe your daddy was a deacon. Maybe your daddy was a preacher. And you just kind of ride their coattails. And faith is not really real for you. I mean, you look the part, you talk the part, but it's not really real in your heart. And you tend to look down on others that are struggling. Perhaps you look at people that come to celebrate recovery and you say, oh yeah, well, you're one of those people. Can I tell you something? I am one of those people. You are one of those people if you'd open your eyes to it. Don't be like the crowd. Be like Zacchaeus and move towards faith in humility. I love the section of Scripture that we've been just kind of in for the past few weeks, because this is a beautiful portrait of Christ. The last words in today's text. Look at it with me. Verse 10. Jesus had just pronounced, today's salvation has come to the house of Zacchaeus. He's the son of Abraham. Verse 10, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Came to seek and save the lost. Jesus, the God-man, has moved upon this earth. And he is moving upon this earth to seek and to save the lost. I want you to look at chapter 18 with me. Chapter 18, verses 31 is where I just kind of want to read there for a second. But as you turn there, I want you to think about our last few weeks in the Gospel of Luke. We saw Jesus say, don't be like Lot's wife. Remember who Lot's wife was? Lot's wife loved her comfortable life. She loved, you know, her wall-to-wall carpeting. She loved her Mercedes out in the garage. She just loved her comfortable life. She was going on about life like everything was just fine. And Jesus says, don't be like Lot's wife who can't let go. Be like the widow who persistently prays for the justice of God to come and who gives up. We saw the Bible scholar and the thieving tax collector praying at the temple. And the Bible says that the thieving tax collector walks away justified by God, while the Bible scholar walks away unjustified. We saw the rich ruler who didn't want to give up what he had to follow Jesus. And I briefly mentioned it, and we didn't read it, but right after that story is the story of the blind beggar who receives his sight because he's just yelling out to Jesus, have mercy on me. And then we end up with the story of Zacchaeus. And nestled right in the middle of all of that, we see how Jesus seeks and saves the lost. Look at verse 31 with me. Jesus took the 12 aside and told them this. We're going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be delivered over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. They will flog him, and they will kill him. But on the third day, he will rise again. What we see here are the events leading up to Easter. What we see is a portrait of Jesus as the Savior who lays down his life, who gives up his everything to seek and save the lost. Can I tell you something? We have read it over and over and over in the past few weeks. That can I tell you, it is not, and I'm not going to, a lot of times when preachers tell this story, they try to cop out of it, and they say, now I'm not telling you, and I think I even said it a few weeks ago, I'm not telling you, I'm telling you, Jesus wants you to abandon everything for him. He wants me to abandon everything for him. That means I got to be willing to abandon my kids to follow Christ. That's what Jesus is calling us to. And you know what? We look at that and we say, how in the world could Jesus ask us to abandon everything? Can I tell you something? He abandoned everything for you. He gave it all up for you. And he expects no less from us. Jesus is portrayed as the one who loves the people that are ignoring him. Jesus is portrayed as the one who loves the rich men of this world. Jesus is portrayed as the one who loves the blind beggars of this world. And Jesus is portrayed as the one who loves the thieving tax collectors that scandalously steal money from people. And Jesus is portrayed as the one that calls all of these people to himself. You're in that mix. And I'm in that mix. And the only thing that we can do with all of that is just to respond. Can I tell you something? Jesus is calling your name. I don't care if you have been in church for 50 years or this is your fifth time here. Jesus is calling your name. Will you respond like Zacchaeus, where you empty out the money bags of your life in front of Jesus and say, here's everything I have. Take me. I'm yours. I don't care about any of that stuff. I just want you. Will you respond in humble faith and repentance? Or will you respond like the crowd in self-righteousness? Whoa, I don't think that's the way it should be done. I don't think that's right. We shouldn't be doing that. We shouldn't be going after those people. We shouldn't be ministering to those people. How will you respond today? Like Zacchaeus, or like the crowd? Let me pray.